openings to video games.
They can last a couple minutes or a couple hours. They can be loud, quiet, emotional, disorienting, devastating, anything really, depending on the experience the developers are going for. Openings set the tone for the rest of the game. They should establish the location, characters, conflicts, theme, and not to mention act as a tutorial on how to play the game, and they ideally give the player a vertical slice of what's to come. Done well, and an opening makes the player invested, eager to keep playing. Done poorly, an opening can overstay its welcome, fail to set up the stakes, or build up any momentum. The player can be left bored or confused and might dip out after only an hour or two.
I'm tired.
Video games have many classic openings, but for my money, very few do it as well as Grim Fandango.
Buenos dias.
Written and directed by Tim Schafer and published by LucasArts in 1998, Grim Fandango is widely considered the pinnacle of, and informal end to, the era of early adventure games.
Twist me up one of them, huh, fella?
Yeah. Twist this, all right?
Over 20 years later, it's easy to see with your own squishy human eyeballs why Grim Fandango is special. It's got memorable character designs, a striking art style, a vibrant soundtrack, and a film noir-like presentation. It's Casablanca meets Mad Men meets Coco, and if that sounds like a weird combination, Grim Fandango's best quality, its writing, makes this world feel natural and lived in by the end of the opening cutscene, which is only 3 minutes long. In this video, I'll attempt to strip Grim Fandango's excellent opener down to the studs to examine how and why it works so well. So, how much does Grim Fandango's opening cutscene actually set up, especially if it's only 3 minutes? On the surface, not much happens. We open on Celso, a skeleton. The Grim Reaper enters, introduces himself.
My name's Manny Calavera.
But he's actually a travel agent, shows Celso some fancy travel packages to the great beyond, checks Celso's records, finds he qualifies for nothing, and sends him on his way with a walking stick. Manny returns to his office, grumbling about his string of bad clients.
I need better clients. I need a real saint. I need a lead on a rich, dead saint.
The end. Like I said, not much happens, right? Right? Let's go back to the beginning of the cutscene. When we open on Celso, hunched over a desk, tucked into the corner of the frame, he feels isolated and small. Then, the literal shadow of death falls across the floor.
Sorry for the wait, Mr. Flores. I am ready to take you now.
Take me? Take me where?
When we get our first look at the protagonist, Manny Calavera, notice how Manny fills the entire screen. The camera, set low, gazes up at him as he pauses for dramatic effect. This series of shots, death's shadow, Celso's scared reaction, the nervously tapping feet, Manny's cool assurance, the intimidating reveal, these all establish that Manny Calavera is, in screenwriting terms, the driver of the scene. He motivates it, moves it forward, makes it happen. He's in control of the situation because who's more in charge than death itself? But Manny throws a curveball by introducing himself as
I'm your new travel agent.
I don't want a new travel agent. I want to go home.
A sudden shift like this can lead the player to ask questions like, what does he mean by that? Why the death robes and scythe then? The imagery on screen clashes with the delivered information, which can draw the player in, sharpening their attention, keep them playing, which is the ideal way of delivering exposition, or the information about setting, biography, and characterization that the audience needs to know to follow and comprehend the events of the story. By the end of Manny's sales pitch, the audience will know that Manny and Celso are dead.
You can't go home, Celso. You're dead. But you're not alone. Everybody here is just as dead as you. That's why we call it the land of the dead.
Celso will take
the 4-year journey of the soul. It is quite a big trip. And I can't lie to you, Celso. It could be very, very dangerous.
And that Manny really is, in fact, just a travel salesman.
Unless you were to take that money you were buried with and buy a better travel package from us. I mean, wouldn't you rather cross the land of the dead in your own sports car?
He'll take the gold that Celso was buried with, which actually becomes a major plot point in the later stages of the game, measure his life's deeds, and see what travel packages Celso qualifies for. But the travel packages aren't just a funny gag and clever take on the afterlife. It's really an outline or spine, no pun intended, that's really what it's called, of Grim Fandango's entire story. A first-time player wouldn't know this yet, but they're actually going to take this journey of the soul with Manny as he travels from car to boat to a ticket on the number 9 train.
There she is. the number 9. One of these days, I'm going to ride her right on out of here.
This is all exposition. But rather than being delivered as a straight-up lore dump, it's dramatized between two characters. Never force words into a character's mouth to tell the audience about the world, history, or person. Rather, show us honest, natural scenes in which human beings, or skeletons in this case, talk and behave in honest, natural ways, yet at the same time indirectly pass along the necessary facts. Manny then checks Celso's records, or the measure of his life's deeds, and finds Celso doesn't qualify for, well, anything at all.
The bad news is the train appears to be just out of your reach.
And by working quickly at his computer, it can secure
the Excelsior Line!
And then it's revealed it's just a walking stick with a compass in the handle. But like most jokes in this cutscene, it's pulling double duty by laying out more of Manny's character to the player. When he's presented with an obstacle, or Celso's bad record, he doesn't just give up and walk away.
I still got a couple of tricks up my sleeve here.
He finds a way to work around it. This shows the player that, by keeping a positive spin on things and deftly weaving through bureaucratic red tape, Manny's really good at his job, which we'll return to in a moment. Put a pin in that. Even after the deal is closed, Manny continues to sell the trip to Celso, saying,
"Oh, you're going to have a great trip. Wish I was going."
"Why don't you? You could give me a lift."
Here, Manny finally drops the sales act as he looks away, hangs his head, and establishes the conflict of this story.
"Oh, I can't leave here until I've worked off a little debt to the powers that be."
Community service, eh?
This is the turning point of the scene. Turning points are very important as they do keep the scene from feeling flat. At the end of a scene, examine the value charge condition of the character's situation and describe it in positive, negative terms. Compare this to the opening charge. If the two are the same, nothing has changed, therefore nothing has happened. Exposition may have been passed to the audience, but the scene is flat. See God of War Ragnarok, which I'll probably make a video about at a later date. Manny, the driver of the scene, begins with a positive charge, dominating the frame, moving the story forward, providing exposition, and working through any obstacles that get in his way. He remains the driver until the turning point when Celso asks,
"Why don't you?"
Manny's body language then changes, externally visualizing his transition into a negative charge. Contrast this with Celso, who begins with a negative charge. He's nervous, intimidated, not in control. But over the course of the scene, Celso warms up to the idea of being dead and taking the 4-year journey of the soul. His body language gradually becomes more relaxed. He stops fidgeting. He reads the brochures. He even nods along as Manny pulls strings to get him
the Excelsior Line.
In their final shot together, Celso practically struts away, taking the camera with him. Manny is literally stuck in place, small and tucked away in the corner, just like Celso was at the beginning of the scene, as he watches Celso do the one thing he can: move on. This makes us feel for Manny as he returns to the office, looking more and more out of place by the moment. He underscores his conflict by muttering,
"Tell Don not to worry. I'm not going anywhere."
Manny opens a filing cabinet converted into a closet labeled Premium Clients, another joke that's pulling double duty because Manny doesn't get premium clients. It's literally a filing cabinet hollowed out to house his robes. But the size of the cabinet implies that either Manny is expected to get premium clients or Manny used to get premium clients, but those days are long gone. Finally, one last visual gag shows Manny for who he really is. Not the intimidating specter of death that he was introduced as, but a regular guy in a cheap suit standing on a pair of lifts. By now, a question should be firmly planted in players' mind. Why doesn't Manny get good clients? We know he's a good travel agent, not because some other character told us he is, but because we've seen him at work. He's the intimidating reaper, the affable salesman, the resourceful pro. When introducing the protagonist, a common choice is to display how they're the best at something. Think Nathan Drake and his encyclopedic knowledge, or Cloud Strife as a highly trained ex-soldier. In the animated Beauty and the Beast, Gaston even expresses this out loud when he says about Belle,
"She's the one! The lucky girl I'm going to marry!
But she...
the most beautiful girl in town!
I know,
Belle! That makes her the best! And don't I deserve the best?"
Well, of course! I mean, you do, but I'm...
There should be a reason why they're the protagonist, after all. And making them the best can provide that. We see Manny as the best when he works to get the Excelsior Line, even commenting later,
"Here's Celso's file. That walking stick was too good for him."
We get the sense Manny used to be on top before we met him. Several later lines of dialogue back this up, like when he's examining his old files.
"I don't want to reread the old files. It'll just make me sad.
Or his rival Domino Hurley's extravagant office door.
My old door.
Or his own current, shabbier office door.
Wasn't too long ago that the name on that door was Supply Closet.
Manny was the best in the business, but now he's a nobody.
Where do they get these guys? They don't qualify for anything good, so I can't sell anything good. I can't work off my time, and I'm stuck. Stuck selling walking sticks to a bunch of burros for eternity.
Though it's not for a lack of ambition, Manny makes this clear when he states his desire, or what motivates the protagonist to act at the beginning of the story.
I need better clients. I need a real saint. I need a lead on a rich, dead saint.
Manny hopes that by landing a rich, dead saint, he may be able to pay off his debt to the powers that be, turn his luck around, and finally take his own four-year journey of the soul. With that declaration of his desire, and the arrival of a mass gazpacho poisoning memo, the player has everything they need to understand the story and are given control of Manny Calavera. Finally, part of the brilliance of this cutscene is that its tone never stays in one spot, but instead cycles through a whole range of moods, motivated by actions and reactions, each one naturally feeding into the next, grounded by characters the player can immediately understand and hopefully emphasize with. The constant shifts in tone help keep the player engaged, like a music track switching up every 4 to 8 beats. Of course, not every scene in every game can have these sort of tonal shifts. Some scenes will be Mozart, some will be Salieri. It really all depends on what the scene needs to get across the necessary information as effectively as possible.
So, now that I've spent over 10 minutes explaining a 3-minute cutscene, hopefully I've been able to get across some of what makes Grim Fandango's opener work so well.
It introduces players to the unique setting of the Land of the Dead, the concept of a 4-year journey of the soul, or the spine of the story, our protagonist Manny Calavera, his conflict of being unable to move on in the afterlife, and his desire to land a rich, dead saint. All this information is dramatized with great jokes and shifting tones, character reveals, swapping of positive and negative charges, and if this sounds like it's a lot to keep track of, yeah, it is. Good writing is an extremely hard balancing act that goes way beyond just snappy dialogue or surprise twists, God of War, Ragnarok, yet can feel so effortless and natural, even when two characters don't have eyeballs or skin, that the craft involved can easily go unnoticed. If you're interested in other examples of good game introductions, I'd recommend Tim Schafer's other big works, Full Throttle and Psychonauts. They're definitely more on the traditional Hollywood style of screenwriting, but hey, as a former Hollywood screenwriter myself, that's just what I gravitate towards. If you have any openers you think are the best, please leave a comment below. I'd love to hear about them. Thank you for watching, and until next time.